All right, to all you math teachers out there, there is a bit of a debate with math teachers whether you grade on paper or you grade online. And I'm here to give you my input and convince you that online grading is the way to go. It is my favorite thing. It's better than sliced bread. I don't know how to say it more. English teachers, I don't know how you do it, grading all those essays. So this is not for you, but I think there is a way you could do it with English teachers, but I think it's going to be a little harder. Online grading is king, and that I will stand behind it. I have done online grading solely for about 10 to 12 years, and I kind of factored it in about 15 years ago, somewhere around there. I used to grade papers, and I'll talk about that, but I say online grading is king. Paper grading. Here are the pros. Great feedback to the kids, able to grade steps for each problem. You can check to see if kids understand the problem rather than just getting it lucky. Able to get partial credit. This is a big one, and this is what I've struggled with a lot with the online grading. This is probably the biggest thing, is not giving partial credit to the kids. But if you do it correctly online, you could possibly. Less cheating. So I would actually venture to say if you do online tests correctly, assessments correctly, the cheating is down to 0%. I've got a website that I've created that tells you if a kid gets off the website, it can mix up the problem so kids can't see problems from other computers. So it's my website that I've made is foolproof. I don't think there's any cheating, but you could argue that paper grading is less cheating, even though you could look on the kid beside you. Cons to paper grading: time, 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 time. Time that it takes to grade papers, and I'll give you some of my stats at the end. Online grading. Here are the cons first, and I'll admit to these cons. I know there's cons. I'm willing to admit that yes, there are these cons. Sometimes it's hard to see if a kid really understands a problem or not. It's hard to see if they're going through the steps of a problem. So every math teacher in the world will say we need to see steps to a math problem. More risk of cheating, possibly, if you're not monitoring well or if you don't have the proper website. It might be easier to cheat through Google. Kids don't need to show their work. Every math teacher you've grown up with has said, show your work, show your work, show your work. So kids don't really show their work on online grading. So that's a con. Instant feedback to the kids. My kids click submit, they instantly get their grade. They instantly are told what problems they got wrong. I instantly see it. Sometimes I'll pull kids up to my desk and work with them on the problems they got wrong. It's instant. Kids can review the test forever. If you give a test back to a kid, they're probably going to lose it. And online, they've got on my website, they've got a tab that goes to test, and they can see all their tests. They can see all their data for the rest of the year, as long as they have an account to my website. Parents have a better shot at seeing the test and a grade. They don't get lost going home, so kids can log into their kid's account and see their test and their grade. If designed correctly, a teacher can still see the steps of a problem. And that's very important of how you design an online test. You can't design it like a paper test. It's got to be a little bit different. If designed correctly, a student will have to show work to solve the problem. So I kind of came to the conclusion that if my test could be done without showing any work, then maybe I need to up the ante on the test. Maybe it's my problem as a test maker. So if I design the test correctly, kids are going to be forced to show their work. Retests are easier. So if your school or your teach you as a teacher, retests are real popular nowadays. So if you need to give a retest, you could, like through my program that I've made on my website, I can shuffle the questions or get brand new questions that are exactly the same difficulty level and same topic. So it's much easier to give a retest for if you do it right. All right, so here are some examples of how I give questions to a test that will kind of help to see if the kid knows what they're doing, and it takes the place of showing work, if you want to call it. When you multiply 34 times 56, get the first row of numbers. So I'm not asking for the answer. I'm asking for the first row of numbers because some kids don't do it correctly or they cheat or whatever else. So whenever during COVID, this was very good to do because during COVID, you can't see if they're cheating or not. So when we're remote, this is a great problem. For 4 plus 4 divided by 4 plus 6 order of operation problem, what is the first step in solving the problem? You could do this by multiple choice. It could be A, 4 plus 4, 4 divided by 4, 4 plus 6. You could have a multitude, or you could say something like it doesn't matter. So if you design these questions correctly, you can really tell if the kids are learning. For a rectangle with a length of 6 and a width of 3, how would you solve for the area? So you're not actually solving for area. You're just saying, hey, how would you do it? And you could have answer choices: A, 6 plus 3, 6 times 3, 6 divided by 3, 6 plus 6 plus 6. So I give answer choices that are popular wrong answers that kids do. I don't ever give a throwaway question or a throwaway answer. I always try to make sure that the kids really know what they're doing. So these are examples of problems that I've done that show a kid's understanding, and it kind of takes the place of seeing those steps. All right, when I used to paper grade, I took an hour per class per test. And I usually, almost every year I've taught, I've had 5 classes. So that's 5 hours. And we're not talking 5 hours of getting a snack and getting a drink of water and that kind of stuff. It's 5 straight hours of grading. So usually I would do it on a Sunday. I would even go into school. I would dread Sundays because I would spend 5 to 6 to 7 hours grading, especially if I'm watching TV. And of course you could say don't watch TV, but it's so boring to grade tests. By the first quarter, in the first quarter, you already knew what the kids were going to get. The kids that worked hard and studied, you knew what their grade was going to be. The kids that slacked and didn't do anything, you knew what their grade was going to be. So I think time is wasted on paper grading. Turnaround time was usually a week or more with me. And unless you are Superman, where you can give a test on a Wednesday and grade it that night and give it back on Tuesday, if you can do that, that's amazing. Hats off to you. But most people have things going on in their lives that they just can't spend 4 to 5 hours grading tests that very night or even within a week. Think about you get a test on a Friday and you want to go hang out with your friends all weekend and have a trip, have a family trip. Guess what? You're on Sunday, got a pit in your stomach because you've got to grade those tests. So you put it off, you put it off. A week later goes by and kids are asking about the test. Parents are asking. Hard time keeping track of kids who are absent. So the biggest problem I had with paper grading is kids would be absent and, I knew it. But then the next day you wake up and out of 100 kids I usually have every year, I can't remember. And yeah, I could look at my grade book and they got lost in a shuffle. And sometimes kids just ended up not ever taking a test because I just forgot. Have to carry around all the papers, keep them separated. Doesn't seem like a big deal, but I would carry these plastic bins and I would carry the papers home and, they'd fall apart in my car. They'd come home and I'd have to, I don't know. It was just a pain to carry them around. One time my cat peed on them and the parents demanded the test, of course. And I had to spray the papers with some Lysol and stuff. But yeah, my cat took the bin that I had and used it as a litter box. Many times a kid is absent, and when I pass the test back, and by the time I got the test back to the kid, a couple of weeks have passed. So let's say a kid is absent on a Wednesday, you pass back the test on a Wednesday. They're not back till Monday of the next week. You forget about it that time. You have a special place you put to kids that are absent their test, and you forget about it. They forget about it, and then 2 weeks after the test was given, they finally get it back. They forgot the topic. They don't even know what they did. No name on papers meant more time tracking it down. I would say out of 100 papers, I would have on average 10 not put their names on the paper. By the end of the year, you could whittle it down to two or three, but you're still spending that extra time. Whose is this? Then there's three people absent that day in that class. So then you got to go to the class the next day and hold it up and say, whose is this? And then, you can take off points and then a parent gets mad because you take off 10 points because they don't put their name on it. It just got difficult. It just gets difficult. That's all. Hard to read handwriting. Can't tell you the number of times where a kid couldn't read their handwriting. And it was also, I thought it was a 5. The kid came back and said it was a 6. Who's right? Even if the kid didn't mean it to be a 6, they say it was because that was the right answer. I don't know. It just got to be too much of a debate and a fight. All right. So all of this combined, I get the argument of math teachers want to show work. Math teachers want to see that work. I used to be like that. I've done this for over 30 years. And the first 10, 15 years, I said, got to show work. No math teacher would ever be a math teacher without work being shown. I give all online tests. I don't spend time grading. It's done instantaneously. I do spend a lot of time preparing for the test the first time, but then I can reuse the test for years later. I have my own program I've made with a programmer, and I have a database of questions, and I can have the program make the test for me, quizzes for me, homework for me. I don't have to grade it. Homework is graded online, tests are graded online. Notebook quizzes are great online. It's all done instantaneously. And I have a lot more free time. And I have more time to plan. And that's the biggest thing. I used to get sucked into not being able to plan. Now I've got plenty of time to plan. So I know there's going to be people out there that are traditional with with the paper, and I get that. But think about it. If you're an eighth grade teacher and you are given a test with slope and graphs, your test is probably about 3 to 4 pages long. So just the time it takes you to flip a page and grade it, flip a page and grade it, flip a page and grade it, takes time. That's a lot of time out of your day where my argument would be you could easily make an online test and give it, and it accomplishes the exact same goal. Now you might say, well, what about your test scores? Well, I've had exceeded growth every year except for maybe one, and maybe I think that was during the pandemic when we were hardly ever in class. They met growth, didn't exceed it. I've never had a year where I didn't meet growth, where I did not meet growth for my kids. My test scores are usually some of the highest in the school, if not the highest, usually. I see learning happening. I don't hear of the next year teacher saying the kids don't know this or know that. So I don't see any downside to online grading. Maybe the steps aren't followed as strictly, but I don't know. I think the kids that are going to get the steps and know them are going to do them anyways, because you're going to have to if you ask the right questions. So that's my take. Again, with the website that I've made along my programmer, it's easy peasy. It's instantaneous feedback. The kids see it, the parents see it. It's time stamped. It tells you exactly how long a kid spends on each problem. It tells you how long a kid spent on the test. You could even let the kid finish it up at home if it was a kid with an IEP. So there's a lot of advantages to it that the paper copy doesn't give. Feel free to comment. Feel free to give me your take on this. Feel free to make a video and give me your take. I'm willing to listen. I guess I'm just at the age that I'm not willing to spend 5 to 7 hours grading every single test and then 2 hours or 3 hours grading quizzes. So let me know.